That's the reason why we decided that we use always this contract record and just update it if a new version is published, because it applies for all licensed Springer products we have ever purchased. Date of beginning is the date from the last version of the contract. And currently we think about using a fake date, because the contract also affects on agreements we have purchased before the date, but we have not finally decided. In organization, we only connect the licensor and the negotiator, never the supplier, because the supplier can be different in a single agreement and which are connected with the contract. The link in main documents is not a real link, it's just a file path in our internal drive. And the following conditions we have filtered out. That part, interlibrary loan is possible. And if we have if we had a copyright notice, we are allowed to send these documents electronically, but this doesn't apply for document delivery services. And unlimited users can access the full text at the same time, and walk-in users are allowed to use the full text. Okay, that was a short overview about our current experiences and considerations in the licenses app. Thank you for your attention.
That's about why I think I'm sad and frail and not the building.
I don't get it.
Why is the file path a URL and not a real link?
It doesn't work yet.
Okay. Yeah. Yes. At the moment, we're not storing that. Yeah.
We have to mute.
No feedback. Great. Is that better? Online. But really, we didn't become Duke until 1924, when we got a really big tobacco money endowment from James Duke. So we're going to be celebrating a centennial next year. And there'll be lots of hoopla at Duke if you want to come down and visit. I can't seem to get my slides to advance. Hello. That'll be a problem. Why aren't they moving? I guess I could do it the old-fashioned way there. Okay. This guy. Okay. So I'll just spend some time introducing what licenses are in Folio, just conceptually for anybody who's new to that, how we prepared to implement the app when we did it 3 years ago, the process that we followed to get our data ready, and then give you a quick demo, a peek into our production system, and then some feedback, I guess, for Owen and the SIG, just things that we like or that we'd like to see different. So if you all are already familiar with these apps, you can check your Slack and take a nap. But just wanted to give kind of the context for what we at Duke refer to as Folio ERM, since there is no such thing in practice. It's just a series of apps. We're using the licenses app. We haven't implemented agreements at Duke because we use the Ex Libris, the 360 knowledge base, to track our electronic resources. And so until there is an integration with Folio for that, it didn't make a lot of sense for us to set up agreements. There's the eHoldings app for folks who are EBSCO customers. They've got that integration already set up. There's the eUsage app, which we are using at Duke. We implemented that in January, and we like that as well. And I guess dashboard could also kind of be considered part of the ERM universe, maybe. So in order to set up our licenses at Duke, we had to create our organizations that we would link to our licenses. We had to set up our users, obviously, and do some configuration settings. So really basic, when we're talking about an organization in the organizations app, we're talking about an entity like a vendor, a publisher, a consortium, and we link those records lots of places, licenses, agreements, orders, and invoices. For license, this is where we get a little squirrely with our vocabulary. At Duke, we always refer to things as a license agreement. And in Folio world, we've split that into two different concepts. So in this context, in Folio, when we say a license, we're talking about that actual like legal document that represents that relationship with one of our providers. And the record in Folio will give us a link to our full text license contract. It'll give metadata about the terms of use that are part of that relationship, any amendments, contact information and notes, and then links to agreement records or anything else that you build out. I really wish I could get rid of this. I guess I can't. Oh wait, hide floating. Let's watch Julie learn how to use Zoom. No. Okay, we'll just leave it. Wishful thinking. The agreement, separate from the license, that's what we think of as kind of a basket. This is a building in Ohio that used to be the headquarters of, the basket company, Lindeberger. We think of it as a basket or a hub or a spoke where you're holding all the links to different types of records, your order, your licenses, and then obviously your e-resources, which for us, we can't integrate. So we haven't implemented, as I said, the agreements app. E-usage, I won't have time to show you our implementation, but it allows us to retrieve our counter reports directly, harvest those via Sushi from, we have about 86 providers that we've set up at Duke to retrieve those usage statistics. So now I'll talk a little bit about how we came to Folio, the universe that we came from 3 years ago. We were storing our license documents in filing cabinets and just in SharePoint, the ones that we had scanned. We had those in SharePoint. We were using Trello to manage our workflow for our staff. And we had a lot of spreadsheets with contact names, vendor platform URLs and credentials. So we were really excited. As part of our move to Folio, we switched also to Box so that we'd have a little more organized system that we could control our passwords and permissions better in Box than we could on SharePoint. We're still using Trello, and now we use Folio to manage all of our contact stuff, as well as the credentials that you'll see when I show you a record. We did a lit review because we're librarians. before we started our implementation, because we weren't on an ERM, we hadn't already created metadata about our licenses, and we wanted to know what other institutions had learned and what to prioritize. So originally we thought that the use cases would center mostly around folks like in circulation that wanted to know if ILL is allowed or, you know, what the terms were. But from our lit review, we found that the majority of ERM users are those who are actually working with it on a day-to-day basis. So we felt like that gave us permission to kind of focus on our use cases and how we plan to be using it day by day. So we didn't work on integrating it to expose those terms in our discovery layer, for instance. But we do have it set up. If folks in other departments or in other parts of the library want to be able to get in, they can do that, but we focused on ourselves. And also found that it's definitely the intellectual work of setting up that metadata is the time-consuming part for this, is sitting down with that license in hand and crawling through the terms and figuring out how to model that in the system. So then we did some data prep, and optical character recognition also stands for obstacle course races. I didn't know that, but we prepped our data by, we had some existing files that hadn't been scanned for OCR to make them a little more searchable. So we had an intern who did a lot of that work. We figured out how to get our file structures a little more organized, and we looked at file naming schemas and tried to get our stuff cleaned up before we put it into our new system. And when we share out the slides, you can see the links to our lit review in case anyone's going down that path. Of course, it's a little stale now because that was back in 2020. So now I'll run through some of the process we took internally as a team to get our stuff into Folio before I do our demo. It took a lot of teamwork, obviously, to get this all together. So I have to give a shout out to our team at the time, some of whom have left Duke. We have one of our team members, Anu, is no longer with us, and some of the folks, their department names have changed, but basically we had a great set of subject matter experts who do this work on a daily basis and a strong product owner. And I'm trying to advance the slides again. There we go. This was 2020. We didn't know what was coming. And we had set a date of July starting in January to get all of this work done. And somehow we still met that deadline. We started by figuring out the scope, what processes did we want to start using in Folio? And it was three. We wanted to be able to create and manage our licenses. We wanted to move all of our contact information in, so the people that we work with at these various providers. And we wanted to get our credentials in for their admin platforms. So we kept it nice and small. We ignored that agreements was a thing and just focused on licenses. So we followed this implementation, very structured set of tasks, going through the workflows, thinking about reporting, going through the settings app to decide how we wanted to configure our terms. And then we did a lot of documentation structure so we could do training. We set up our permissions and did some testing, found a few bugs, and rolled it out in July of 2020. So yeah, we're really proud of our user documentation internally. And if I have time, I'd be happy to pull that up. But we basically start with a workflow diagram, and then we have step-by-step instructions for how to create a license, edit one, amend one, and then field-by-field guidelines, and so that folks adding and creating new records know what the naming conventions are, for example. So what worked well for us in our implementation, we kept our team really small. As you saw, it was just a handful of us. We had a strong product owner who knew what she wanted. We had a small, clearly defined scope that we stuck to. We had a project task roadmap that we also kept ourselves accountable to. And we used simple tools like Excel. We didn't use you know, a big project management tool to keep us on track. I was the business analyst in this effort, and I always came to the group with a draft, even though I didn't always know what I was doing. So we had something to work off of, rather than just spending our time once a week starting from scratch. We found it best to have Folio up because we were in the middle of the lockdown. We were remote and we were all on Zoom. So we would we'd have one person be the driver, have Folio up and running. And we found that was the best way to take turns being the driver, learning how to use the system, rather than like me just coming in and saying, watch my screen. So that active learning worked well. And we stayed really tightly involved in the ERM working group to see what was going on and what features might be coming, and learning from other institutions. So those are the things that worked well. And now I'll try to toggle over and open up our production system. I might have to, y'all can look at my schedule. Oh, how do I open up my... There we go. All right, so now I'm in our production system, and I'll show you one of our organization records first, since that's where we need to start. None of these are set up as vendors. We built all these records from scratch rather than doing any data migration. And we have it looks like we have 575 organizations that are linked to licenses currently. And we have a lot of typical with Folio, we have the left search pane, and we can filter by types and tags and whether it's a vendor or not. But what I really like is the alternate name. If I put in OUP for Oxford University Press, because we've set that up as an alternate name here, that comes up when our search interrogates that field. So we have a naming convention that we're following where we put an E in the front of an existing code value that's from our legacy system, just to highlight that this is one that's set up for our electronic licenses. And the fun part is the contact people, where we can now see those names and numbers without having to go into a spreadsheet. And then our interfaces, we have the URL to the admin platform. I won't show you the credentials, but we can store the credentials there and any notes. One thing that we would love to see in the future is if we could also see an accordion maybe with the link directly to the license. So if we could be looking at an organization and see, oh, here are all the licenses or the license associated with this organization, we could just pop straight over there. But as it is, I'm going to need to either open up another browser or go in and open up the licenses tab. So now I'm in our licenses app, and it automatically sets the filter to active. We also find that kind of odd. That's an inconsistent behavior across apps where the default filters are set. But for licenses, we appreciate that it's defaults to active. If I select them all, then you can see the count at the top. We have 711 licenses in production right now. And on the left search and filter pane, the type value, we hijacked that. That type comes out of the box as values like local, consortial, national. We needed a way locally to be able to distinguish who the licensing library was within our organization. We did not set Folio up as a consortial, we're all sharing the same instance, but we needed a way to distinguish that. So that'll show up as one of our kind of like quibbles, I guess, that we kind of had to work around, and that might bite us in the future if that type changes in some way. So what else is different? The rest we kept standard, and you can filter, of course, by the organization that's linked to the license. And we really like the terms filter, where you can, let's say I want to look for all the licenses that have interlibrary loan permitted for some reason. I can just use the filter to look for a yes. And I could do then an and statement if I wanted to also then look for ones that have a confidentiality statement or something. So we really like the robust filtering options. So I have 241 that were a hit for that. So if I turn off my filters and search for a specific license, I obviously, like with all of our Folio apps, it'll bring my detail pane open for me. And I can see in my type that this is one for our main library, that it's active, and that it's open-ended as an end date. One thing that our users mentioned they'd like to see in the future is if it does have an end date, perhaps it could be optional that that triggers the status to change from active to expired. That might not be something everybody would want, but if we could configure that in settings optionally. Right now we have some sitting out there that have an end date, you know, of like February 2023, but they're still showing as active, and someone's gonna have to go in and manually flip those. So that might be a nice little automation in the future. So we went with the same naming convention that you introduced. We do the name of the vendor, the provider, whoever, with a colon, and then the title that we actually see on the license document, and then the year. If I expand our metadata, you'll notice it's lacking a couple fields that we see in other apps. I can't see who created the record or who updated it. So that's another thing I've gotten feedback from our users. If we could extend some of that metadata, they'd like that. They had a description. We link it to the organization record. And I love that we can see right here the interface platform link. That's really handy. We don't have to toggle back over to the organization's app to see that. And similarly, for our core documents at Duke, we have a link to our box folder where we're storing them. And because I have permissions to that folder, it'll just bring it right up and I can look at it. So we didn't upload them to our Folio server. We have them stored in Box. And that way we can control permissions. If staff aren't allowed to see the document, they can control that over in Box. Let me move this guy just so we're not dealing with him. The terms, we phrased all of ours in the form of a question just to reduce the amount of intellectual work you have to do when you're reading the term of use description. So we put them all as questions. Is it included or not? And then in the internal note, we've cut and paste from the license document the language for that section, which, as I said, we're not exposing that in our discovery layer. It's just here in our license record. And we've set all of these up. If I have time, I'll show you in settings. We have our all set up as primary terms so that they automatically list as you're creating a new license. You can also hide them and have people actually, well, that's getting in the weeds. But we love the flexibility that we can either show them all and make them think about it, or you can have them just show up in a drop-down box, basically. So we have 11 on that one. We have some amendments here on this one. And here you can see an example where this amendment from 2021 is showing as active, but the end date has already passed. So someone's going to need to go in there and update that one. If I click into an amendment, it's going to feel exactly like the header license, where you're seeing a lot of the same fields. Tells us the status of the amendment. We have another chance to describe this one. What I like, we added relatively recently that it also points you back to where you just were on the parent license. If you're getting a little lost or you toggle over and you're doing another task and you come back seeing that parent license, oh yeah, I'm looking at an amendment. And then you have core documents down here that are related to the amendment. So again, I could click into Box and view the full text of the amendment document. And sometimes we have terms that are specific to the amendment, but in this case, I think they're all. Oh, we do have one, DKU. For us, DKU is our China campus, Duke Kunshan University. So the amendment This is a DKU subscribe title. That must be why we amended it. So that was a really quick run through of the basics of how our licenses look in production. I'm trying to move this bar and it will not come with me. So I'm not watching chat.
You can ask other questions maybe at the end.
Okay, sure. Okay. I'll go ahead and just wrap up the slides and then okay, so we got through the demo part, and I think I've touched on a lot of the strengths and quibbles that we already had, but let me make sure I didn't miss any. So the things we love about the licenses app, and as many of you may heard, Duke is moving away from Folio next year and adopting another system. I'd be happy to talk with that afterward with anyone who wants to talk about that. But the folks who are using the licenses app are very happy with it. They love the e-usage app. And one of the big strengths is this community, the really knowledgeable and engaged community that we've worked with standing up this part of the system. And we find that it's really well integrated. The fact that if we did set up the agreements, that those link in eventually to your BIB records, and that's very powerful. And as I was showing you, those search and filter options are powerful as well. Some of our quibbles with the agreements app, yeah, the fact that we can't integrate beyond GoKB and the EBSCO products is limiting, not just for us. The organizations app, it feels a little clunky to manage your contacts if anyone's played with that. It requires like several levels of clicks, and that feels a little clunky. Similar with the interfaces and the notes, they just feel a little clunky. For the licenses, we had to hijack the type to be able to indicate which of our local libraries this license is associated with. So we set up the type to handle that, but I could see other institutions being in the same boat and wanting to be able to use the type to indicate that it's national or local or consortial, but also be able to indicate which of their local libraries is the licensee. What else? There was one more for licenses. Oh, and they also want to be able, our users want to be able to distinguish at the amendment level which library it belongs to. So if the original license was for the law library, but the amendment is being handled through our main library, they'd like to be able to distinguish between the header and the amendments. What else? On the organizations app, yeah, I mentioned they'd like to be able to see the list of licenses from within the organization so they could just hop right into those. In the licenses app, one of the actions is to be able to export to CSV the full license record, which is a great feature, but currently the pagination requires you to click on each. Yeah, Owen's making a face. Yeah. So yeah, we're aware of this as a community, but of course they still remind me every once in a while that that's annoying. So the ability to be able to select all or select all in a filter set would be great. Adding some more metadata to see who created and edited the record, and then the automated expiration would be great. But I mean, those are pretty minor. So all in all, lots of satisfied folks at Duke. And I can stop and see if there are any questions.
I'm going to come closer to the mic. Any questions in the room? I see Felix raising his hand. Give me a second. I can come to you.
Hey, Julie. Thanks for your presentation. That was really inspiring. So one question about the organizations app. So what we have there already, but you are not using agreements, is that you have an accordion linked agreements to this organization. And we were looking at orders and the purchase orders. And what we found that there is no option from the organization to see all the POLs or the POs that are linked to this as well. So that seems like a related use case. And what we don't want to have in context with orders is a list of just all the orders, because that will get overwhelming long. So what we thought, maybe it would be better to have like a button, show all orders, that could be the same for show all agreements. Then you go in a new tab to agreements or to licenses, and you have your app, and the filter on the organization is pre-filled with the organization you came from. Would that be something you would find useful as well?
Yes. The orders,
yeah.
To have that linking right there in the organization app, that makes a lot of sense. So I hope there's a Jira for that.
And there is one question. I think you may have answered that already. For Duke, was the rescan of licenses with OCR to go into Box, or are you also uploading to Folio?
We didn't also. We only put them in Box. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
There is one other question. Why did you put your docs on Box rather than at EBSCO? Why did you do no data migration, but rather create records from scratch?
The second one first, we weren't migrating from an existing ERM, so we didn't have any metadata to migrate. So we had to do all that intellectual work to describe our licenses. So that's why we chose not to migrate. We didn't have that data. And because we'll be leaving Folio, we will now need to migrate from licenses to another system. So we'll get to migrate. We just got to do the initial setup in Folio instead of coming from another system. And the first question was about...
Why did you put your docs on Box rather than at EBSCO?
Right. Well, we're hosted by Index Data. That's our hosting provider. So we could have uploaded them to our server, but we chose, because Box, we could have a lot more control over folders and organizational structure within Box, and then also control permissions there through our shibboleth. That's why we went with that. Okay. Yeah.
Any more questions?
Would you be willing to share your instructions?
The wiki page? Yeah, I can share it. Okay. Yeah, I think those are public. So I think they are. I guess we'll find out if I drop the link in chat. That's one way. Yeah, let's see if that works. So we start out the page. Well, we're at time. So if anyone wants to leave, they can.
But ask for NetID and password.
Oh, yeah. Okay, so it's behind the wall.
Yeah.
Darn. But feel free to contact me and I could figure out a way to at least export the content, okay, you know, to a PDF. Perfect. Not that is helpful, but Owen.
Thank you very much, both of you, for your presentations. It's great. I work on the development of the design and development side of this, and I would love hearing real use and seeing what the shortcomings are and where we can go. I wanted to say, you mentioned using amendments, and just to say, it's one of the things we get feedback on amendments all the time, is that you can only find the amendment via the license at the moment. So you search for the license, and then mm-hmm. if there are three amendments like you have, you can't search for those independently. In Poppy, you will be able to search for those separately. So if you have lots of amendments, you'll be able to search for the amendment and navigate back up to the by term as well, all the same searching as for licenses, and then navigate back to the parent licenses. That's what you've got to do.
And that's in Poppy?
That would be in Poppy.
Great, okay.
And just to say, Julie, you've shared before as well, but thank you so much for the work you're doing. We'll miss you in the
Well, community. Thank you. That's sweet.
That's sweet.
And people just said that they cannot hear us very well. I'm not sure whether that helps, whether we use the mic. I don't know. So we are louder in the room. Owen, can you say something to the URL path? I know you answered that in chat, but maybe you can say something.
I was just the URL path can be a file path, but support for file path depends on the browser and the operating system. Like Windows supports where you put file :// and then a drive or network drive address, and those should work as long as the browser and operating system support, but you'll find variation between browsers and Mac OS and different. So apart from that, it'll support also URLs, as we see here. You can do direct upload. You can also record physical locations in the document. So that's why the document, when we have a document record, it's not a file specifically, because it could refer to a filing cabinet or something where the document is stored. But you can have, and you can have multiple, you can have the physical location and the URL if it's in both. but the URL can also be an FTP URL if you've got them, or as you know, a box URL if you want, or on the supplier's website. So I think there are lots of options. Even hidden behind the choose file upload, there are two different ways you can configure the system to store the documents, but unfortunately box integration is not one of them. But S3 Amazon storage is one of them, so you can upload to an Amazon storage folder, which you could in theory access directly as well, so you could then have different access to the same files. But it's not designed that way particularly, but it's just a consequence of having the S3 storage in there. I if anybody wants to ask about the options, then they can do. Yeah.
Thank you. Anything else? Any questions in the room or in the chat? There is just the note that the link requires a login and people can reach out to you directly. Yes. Yeah. Any questions? Felix, just a sec.
If there isn't, yeah, anyone else. So I will ask a follow-up question or a second one. So one thing we really like is that there is no automated transfer from the end date to the status. So there is no connection, because we have another system where there is a connection and that has some difficulties as well. So let's say you have a license that has ended, but you still have post cancellation access to it or an agreement. So we find it very flexible, but I also get your point. So maybe we could have both ways supported, so that you could, yeah, be configurable or make it easier to have like a bulk edit, so that you go in by the beginning of the year and you see, I want to see all my licenses with end date 31st of December last year, and I can just by one click have them set to deprecated, or I don't know the exact status, closed with some reason. So yeah, maybe that could be something for the ERM SIG.
Anything else? I can see nothing in chat, no raised hand. Anyone here? And I count down from 5. Ah, sorry, yes.
Have you found any use for the tags feature in working with ERM?
So we tried to avoid the tags feature early on because we couldn't control them, clean them up. So we limited ours to just needs attention, I think. Let me see if I filter by tags. I think we just have a needs attention. Okay, we have an important, an urgent, and it needs attention. So you can see already it's gotten messy, and that's with only 3 values. I don't think so. I think we had to add those, yeah. So yes, we've very limited use, and that was early on when we were building out the records, and there were some that were kind of half finished. They applied that needs attention. But they're doing the workflow in Trello, so they're not using it to control like... I need someone to review this, or I need a signature. It's so very limited use of tags, primarily because we felt like it was underdeveloped and we didn't want to add tags that were misspelled and then we couldn't remove them and it would get messy. So until we could manage the tags, we chose not to use them in production. We have a lot in test where people are just messing around, but yeah.
That's interesting.
That's true. That's all right. I think I described it. Any other? Should I see? Thanks. Yeah.
Okay. I'm showing you.
Oh, I think the name was the
first.
Oh, we do.
Okay.
So, does that
pull out? Okay. Yeah. Sorry. This is just probably more a question for Owen, really. But you had mentioned tags. Is there plans for development on tags? Is that something that's going to be upcoming? Sorry.
I mean, I'm not the product owner for tags, and our team has not done work directly. The only work that we've done in terms of licenses and agreements and is to add support for the tags application as it stands. So I'm probably not the right person to answer that. It did come up in a acquisition SIG discussion recently as like, could, and I cannot remember the topic, I'm afraid, off the top of my head, but there, like, I think I suggested that possibly, like, if it was a tag style thing that you were trying to do, maybe the solution for certain things would be to spend the time improving tags rather than spend the time adding some specific functionality to a module like acquisitions, because they're like orders in that case. But I'm not in a position to make that happen. So I'm not aware of any work planned, but, you know, if people, you know, generally we'll see responsive people start to prioritize that above other stuff. And I think that just hasn't happened. But it might be, you know, I think the sad thing is that it's has a deal of potential, but as it stands, a lot of institutions make exactly the same decision that Duke have made, which is that as it stands, it's not useful enough or not usable enough to want to implement. And so it sits there rather sadly neglected. Needs attention. Needs attention.
And thankfully, I think Kimberly has put the chat to the meeting notes from this acquisitions meeting in this meeting chat. So thank you. Anything else? Then I would like to thank you, Julie, and you, Daniel, for this insight into your plans and your everyday work and life. And yeah. See you soon. Thank you.
Big applause.
Thank you. Bye.